That's packed, the cafeteria's packed, the choir room's packed, they're outside on the grass under the tent. Shoo! There's thousands of people here tonight. Well, I'll tell you something, friend, listen to me. There's an open heaven here. Did you know where there's an open heaven, you can just whisper and God hears? Can you imagine what heaven will hear with an open heaven if we shout unto God with a voice of triumph? Woo! Listen, I tell you what, I want those outside under the tent. I want them in the cafeteria, the choir room, the chapel, and in here. Tell you what, go ahead and open up them back doors, ushers. Open up them side doors over here on both sides. Listen, let's let the devil know in Pensacola. Wait a minute. Open up them front doors all the way out there, the front doors of the church. Open up these other doors. Hurry up. Hurry up. Open them up. Open up the front doors. Listen. God has sent revival to Pensacola. Shoot. Let's let the powers and the principalities know greater is He that is in us than He that is in the world.
I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole.
church like mine. Sweet Sunday. Now, call me free.
see your face, see you smile over us. I'm seeing angels celebrate the joy in this place. Oh.
Hallelujah. Bless you, Jesus. I want to sing one more song before we change the order of the service. And I don't usually do this on Friday nights, but I feel like we need to sing about the blood of Jesus. Is that okay? Miss Hazel, I will put you on the spot. I want to sing God's sacrifice. Come down here and direct this. He was wounded, now we are healed. He was bruised, now we have life. What was our punishment? He took upon himself. Thank you, Jesus. That's why we're dancing. That's why we're worshiping. Hallelujah.
Hey. what's giving up. The sky turned dark, and there in the rain, he prayed for you.
Of the Lord is in this place. I can't wait till Steve preaches. I can't wait for the altar call. And I can't wait to pray for everybody tonight. Wow. Man. There's some power in this place. You may return to your seats, everybody, in all the buildings, if you will, please return to your seats. How many of you feel the presence of the Lord here tonight? Wow. Woo. I heard this booming voice up there in the choir. First time my brother ever started coming to this church, I thought he was standing up all the time. He's sitting down, look at there. He's sitting down. When this revival started, he wasn't but 5 foot two. Stand up, brother. What'd you say? Growing in the Lord, yeah. Man, Brownsville, y'all can sing. Y'all can sing. Y'all appreciate this choir? You appreciate Lyndall Cooley? Old Lindell's a young man, but he knows all them songs. He knows the modern ones and he knows the old ones. That's what I love about him. He even knows some I don't know. And the boy can dance. and his hair can dance. Hallelujah. Amen. So good to have all of you here tonight. Wow. I love the presence of the Lord. Whew. I know what those people feel like when they get up there in the baptismal pool and they look out and they say, whew. I know what they feel. I've felt that 1,000 times. Well, tonight is our 800th and some odd service. I'm not sure how many services, but it's 800 and some odd services. If y'all know back there in the television room, flash it up there on the digital clock for me. If you know back in the television room how many services this is, flash it up there for me. They'll do that in just a minute. Well, where in the world did y'all come from? Wow. Man, there's people outside under the tent. Everything is full on the campus. There's thousands of people here tonight. Wow. Where did y'all come from? How many of you tonight are from the north? Let me see your hand. Stand up if you're from the north. Wow. Just keep standing for a minute. I'm just going to take a sampling. I can't ask everybody. Where are y'all from? Michigan. Hey. Where are y'all from? Huh? Canada, Virginia. Where are y'all from? Rhode Island. Wow. I don't think I've ever met anybody from Rhode Island. Where are y'all from? Back in the back. New York. Where are y'all from over here? Hold your applause. Where are y'all from? Canada, up there in the balcony, where are you from? Wisconsin, hey! Where are y'all from? New York City. New York City? Tonight is the 834th revival service. 834. Where are y'all from? Pennsylvania, where are you from? Canada, right here. Huh? Canada? Where y'all from? North Carolina. Hey! Where you from? Canada? Seattle. That ain't the north, man. Where y'all from? Rhode Island. Hey! New York. Say that again, son. New York. That's the way Mike Brown says it. Mike Brown's New Jersey. All right, how many of you is from the West? Stand up. Where are you from? The West. How many is from California? California? Oregon. Anybody here from Oregon? You're... What about Washington State? What about Idaho? Montana? Alberta. Yeah, I know there's a few of you here from Alberta. All right, you can be seated. How many of you are here tonight from the Midwest? How many of you are here tonight from the South? How many of you are here tonight and you're from outside the continental United States? Stand up. Outside the United States. Hey, all right. Wow. Look at this, watch this. How many of you are here tonight from Brownsville Assembly? Stand up. If you're from Brownsville Assembly, stand up. All right. Hey. Hey, hey, hey. How many of you are here tonight and you're from the state of Florida? How many of you here tonight and you're not from Brownsville and you're not from Florida? Stand up. All right, how many, you may see, how many of you are here tonight and you wasn't here Wednesday night? Let me, you stand up. If you're here tonight and you weren't here Wednesday night, look at this. Look at this. How many of you, this is your first week of revival? Hold your hand up. Just stand up if it's your first week. Stand up. First week of revival. The very first week of revival. Where have y'all been? Man, we've been a revival 340 services, and this is your first time. I hope you don't treat the rapture like that. You'd be halfway into the tribulation by now. Do you know that? Huh? 834. What did I say? I said three. Oh, that's right. Yeah, you're right. Lendl does more than teach you music. Shut up the rest of the service. I'm kidding. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's so good to have everybody here tonight. I know if I ask for the hands of the different faiths represented, we'd have all different faiths represented. We don't like to do that because we don't really like to make anybody feel that they are, you know, different, or Pentecostal or non-Pentecostal, charismatic or non-charismatic. Because the way we look at it here at Brownsville, when we all get together, we're just the family of God. That's what we are. And at the foot of the cross is a common denominator. At the foot of the cross, we're all the same. Red, yellow, black, white, yellow, brown. All different income levels, all different educational levels, we're all the same at the foot of the cross. But we are so happy that all of you are here tonight. Revival broke out in this church 3 years ago. It'll be 3 years ago come June. And on Father's Day will be 3 years that a powerful revival broke out, and it's still going strong after 3 years. And we expect it to still be going strong for quite a time in the future. It looks like, we don't know, but it looks like there's no end in sight. Good. How many of you enjoy having a place to go where you can worship the Lord like this? Isn't that wonderful? I don't think Pensacola can get over it as they drive by day after day and they see the crowds outside. They see the tents, the tarps, and they see people outside in line, rain or shine, cold or hot. They just cannot get over the fact that people are standing outside like that waiting to get into a church. Is it worth the wait? Is it worth the wait? Now I want to say something to you. If you wasn't waiting to get in here, wherever God was moving, you'd be waiting somewhere else to get in. And if God wasn't moving at Brownsville, I would be right out there with you wherever God was moving, and I'd be waiting to get in myself. Because I'm hungry after God myself, and I want all He's got for me. And God is doing a powerful thing. Our evangelist, Steve Hill, has been with us since the onset on Father's Day of 1995. God has used him mightily to preach the gospel. I have literally seen with my own eyes a man that I've been knowing for a number of years, quite a number of years. I've literally seen a mantle come upon him and his ministry. I've seen God change and revolutionize a man of God before my very eyes. A mantle rested on him. I don't know if it was Leonard Ravenhill's mantle. I don't know what it was, but something lit on the man and rested on him. I've seen God develop a powerful man of God in this revival. We don't build up man, but I'm just telling you that's what I've seen as a pastor. I've been pastoring for 27 years. I've been here at Brownsville for 16 years. And when you spend a little bit of time in the ministry, you're fortunate and blessed by God to see a few things. And one of the greatest things that I've ever seen is the outbreak of this revival. It is the greatest thing that I've ever seen, the outbreak of this revival and how God perpetuates it. And the thing that's so amazing about it is how God told us when this thing first broke out, He said, before you even have a need, before you can even discern what the need is, I'll already have the answer on the way to you. And truly, I have seen, in the course of this revival, I have seen God let many needs develop. And even before they developed good, before I could even tell what they were good, He already had people and answers on the way. And it's been a miraculous thing. Tonight, bless you, Lord Jesus. We worship you.
We ask that your power would fall in this place, Lord.
The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. The Spirit of the Sovereign God is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. He has sent you to the poor. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach.
We bless you, Lord.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
We bless you, Lord. Oh, we bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Oh, 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 oh. Lord, we love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I know there's people here tonight. I want everyone standing, those of you in all the other overflow rooms. Let me explain something about the rooms. We do the very best we can to accommodate people here at the Revival. Once again, we didn't start this. We're just doing whatever we can to accommodate folks, so bear with us. It's tough, friends. It's hard. I know some of you came, and maybe you want to be in here, or you wanted to be in another, you know, you're not where you wanted to be. Let me explain something to you. God's there, where you're at, and the bottom line is He sees your heart. We've had some of the greatest miracles in this revival take place in back rooms, because God can come down anywhere. But if you're standing there or sitting there bitter and angry because maybe an usher told you to go over there and you wanted to go over there and you're all ticked and you're gonna let Satan ruin your night. That's ridiculous, friend. That's ridiculous. Don't do that. I remember one night I came to this revival and I was walking in to preach, and there was this girl sitting in the hallway, and we had video screens in the hallways, and it's like tonight, it's just one of those nights. And she was so happy, and I asked her who she was. She told me where she's from, and I said, "You been here before?" She goes, "Nope, first time." But she was beaming, and she said, "I got a seat." You know, and I thought, "Well, yeah, you do." In the hallway, looking at a monitor up in the. But she was thrilled. She was thrilled that she got in the building, and she was going to see the revival, be a part of it. And so God saw that, friend. He sees your heart. So don't be bitter. Let God have His way in your life. And also, those of you that don't want to be here, I've already met a few. You've just got that look. I hate this place look on your face. We welcome you. And those of you that came to mess up the meeting, we welcome you also. Pastors, I want you to get ready. When revival breaks out, they'll show up, trust me. It's like a light. The revival's a big light and attracts a lot of bugs. And man, you'll have some wicked bugs come in there. They'll fly around your light and they'll make all kinds of noises. They'll do all kinds of crazy things. Witches will come try to stop it. People come in here, and the other night, we weren't going to say this that night, but the other night somebody walked by one of the ushers and said, "There's a murderer in the house." You know, like, nah. Call off the meeting. Run for your life. And folks, you know, it's just every night there's something, okay? Who knows who's here tonight? Could be the future high priest of the satanic church. Maybe he'll get saved here tonight. Yep. Glory. Anyway, I want everyone to pray. God's given me a message for tonight. We're going to pray with you in just a minute. I want everyone to pray with me now out loud. Whether you want to be here or not, whether you're a God lover or a God hater, everyone pray with me right now. Dear Jesus, speak to my heart. Change my life. In your precious name, amen. Now, before you're seated, as we prayed that, there's a girl, I believe you're in the cafeteria. Teenager, you didn't pray that prayer. You didn't pray because you're rebellious and you're a snot. And you're not going to pray that prayer. No one's going to tell you to do nothing. I'm telling you, sis, I want you to pray that prayer. You're going to pray. We're going to pray it again. We're going to help you. We're going to pray it again. Everyone's going to pray it out loud. Everybody pray. As a matter of fact, if you see somebody not praying, raise your hand. And I'll call him up here to lead us in this. Everyone pray, dear Jesus, speak to my heart. Change my life. In your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, I can see people then just going, dear Jesus, speak to my heart. Boy. I appreciate Mike covering the dog food issue, but he didn't cover all of it. I got more. It just so happened, we did not talk about this, but this stuff blows my mind. It may not blow your mind, but it blows my mind. So let my mind be blown. for a few minutes. Did you know, not only do we spend $15 billion, those of you from foreign countries, bear with us, okay? Not only do we spend $15 billion a year on Fido, the biggest growth in the pet food market is in cat kitty treats. Kitty treats. It's growing at a rate of 23%. Much, much higher. Doggy treats is only growing at 7%. America's moving towards the cats. You know, on Broadway, there's a play called Cats. Maybe they put one dogs, things will change. But dog treats still fetch $1 billion. We're talking about the little biscuits. Whew. Now, listen to this. If your canine suffers from thunder phobia, or has an over-dominant personality, you may be one of America's pet owners that spends from $80 to $100 an hour to sit down with a certified psychologist by the American College of Veterinary Behaviorists. Can you imagine? I mean, my dog would take him ever just to sit. I mean, just cost me $100 just to get the dog to sit. But what, you know, never mind. If you're a cat psychologist, that's fine. Listen to this. For more severe problems, an animal psychiatrist may be consulted for prescriptions of Prozac for your depressed pet. And for those of you that don't want to give your animals medicine, you can pull up on the website your pet's horoscope, hosted by a woman by the name of Kay Cox. She's a pet counselor. She'll have your cat's horoscope so you can explain to little Fido why he's going through what he's going through. It's a crazy world, friend. Once again, we don't apologize for taking up a missions offering. We had a cat that died 6 months ago, and it was sad, but you know what happened? When a cat dies, he's dead, okay? He's dead, and you bury the cat, okay? I did not go out, forgive me, but I didn't go out and spend $200 on a tombstone. Okay, we just buried the cat. For those of you from other countries, I want to explain to you something before I preach tonight about tipping in America. In America, I've traveled all over the world and it changed. As a matter of fact, I travel with a little booklet that tells you the customs of different countries because I don't want to offend the different countries I go to. There are countries you can go to around the world where if you tip them, they give it back. They don't know what that means, okay? There's other countries where if you don't tip them, you'll know it. Everybody in the restaurant will know it. But here in America, this is for our visiting guests. I hope everyone in America, Christians should be the best tippers. But here in America, and young people, when you go to a Pizza Hut or whatever, you are a pain sometimes. You need to go in there and, you know, have a good time, shout and scream, but leave a little money. Leave some money. They've labored over you. They put up with you. Leave some money. But here in America, I want to share with our foreign guests, it is customary to leave around 15% on the table above the amount on your check, unless in the restaurant it says that the gratuity is already being taken out of. And it's already on the bill. And sometimes when you come in with large groups of 25, they'll say that 15% has already been added to the bill. Check that. Make sure they either have or haven't, and then tip. It is customary in America, and I just want to share that with you because we're dealing. See, when you come and you go, but we live here in this city. And these people, they're waiting on you, and these are Pensacola people, and we want to leave a sweet smell in this city with the Brownsville Revival. So please leave a tip. that has absolutely nothing to do with my message. But it's a good word. This morning I got up early to get tonight's message, and I thought perhaps God would allow me to preach what I didn't preach last night, but he rarely does that. You know, I wanted a free day today, but no, not God. And so I love preaching at the Brownsville Revival, but I want to tell you it's not easy. Because I get up tired, Pastor knows, we get up tired, we work full days, we work 80-hour weeks, we work all day long, and then all the way till 1 o'clock in the morning. That's not a pity party, but I want to tell you, it's like war. It's nonstop. It's nonstop. But he began to speak to me this morning about deliverance, and I thought, well, that's great, Lord. I love preaching about deliverance. And then he brought me to a scripture that I had never, ever preached on, and he never even looked at. And some of you may think it's strange, and that's okay. I'm certain there are pastors and evangelists here that have used this scripture before. I haven't. As a matter of fact, I've got an extensive library, and I found that a lot of other preachers have never used it before. I did find a few theologians, and I don't go to the commentaries before I prepare a message. I go after my message is done to see what other people think 300 years ago or 200 years ago. And I was blessed to see that after I finished the message today, I went to some of the old commentaries, and I found out they saw some of the same stuff. So it showed me that I was on the right track, and I had the peace of God. Would you turn with me to Acts chapter 9? Acts chapter 9. Tonight I'll be speaking from the King James Version of the Bible. Acts chapter 9. How many are going to listen to the word for a few minutes? I hope so. It's the only thing that'll change you. Those of you that are going through mental anguish, you've been on drugs, you've burned your mind out with drugs, alcohol, poisons of the world, I want to challenge you to read the word. Matter of fact, go buy some tapes of the word of God and just play them over and over in your head. God will transform your mind with the word of God. Acts chapter 9. Verse 18, the first few verses of Acts is the conversion of Saul of Tarsus. If you have never read that, you need to read it. It is violent. Say that with me. It is violent. If you don't believe God can whap somebody upside the head with a 2x4, you need to read this story. God can get a hold of people any way he wants. Amen? And I'm going to tell you something else. This will mess up your theology, those of you that believe that God will touch people after they're saved. Saul was hit by the power of God, then he got saved. He had an encounter first, and then he got saved. And Saul was one of those individuals you could not hand a tract to, and like a chick tract, you know, give him a chick tract and say, hey, this is your life, man. And you know, Saul, read this. Saul would throw you in prison. He'd have you home. Saul was the type of man that needed an encounter first, and then he would talk to you. And that's just what he got. Verse 18 of Acts chapter 9. And immediately there fell from his eyes as if it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose and was baptized. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. Certain days, just a short while. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. Now nowhere there does it say he went to the Brownsville Revival School of Ministry. But he began preaching the word. I want to tell you, friends, look this way. I love this kind of stuff. I love it when somebody gets saved, and in the rawest form of Christianity, they walk out on the streets and they go, I don't know much about anything, but I once was blind and now I see. And that's what he was doing. He was a brand new babe in Christ. And here he is preaching the word that Jesus is the Son of God. Verse 21. But all that heard him were amazed and said, is not this he that destroyed them which called on the name in Jerusalem and came hither from that intent that he may bring down them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased some more in strength and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. And after that many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. Welcome, Saul, to Christianity. How many have been beat up right after you got saved? I'm talking about how many have been persecuted right after you got saved. You leave the Brownsville revival, you're on fire for God, you go home, you tell your parents, and they cuss you out. I had that happen with one of my family members. I was a drug addict for years. I would cuss in her house. And she shared this. She's been to this revival. She shared, as a matter of fact, a large newspaper article came out, and she shared how wrong she was as she did this. But I was so on fire for God, I would go over to my older sister's house, and I'd say things like, "Praise the Lord, glory to God," and she would cuss me out and say, "Don't ever use that kind of language in my house again." Fine Lutheran woman. She thought she knew God until she came down to this Brownsville revival. She's been baptized here. God's touched her. I love her to death. Listen, let's go on. After that, many days were fulfilled. The Jews took counsel to kill him, but their laying await was known of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and let him down by the wall in a basket. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. And he was with them coming in and going out at Jerusalem. And he spake boldly in the name of Jesus, the Lord Jesus, and disputed against the Grecians, but they went about to slay him. Which when the brethren knew, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him forth to Tarsus. Then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost were multiplied. Now, friend, I want you to look at verse 25. Then the disciples took him by the night and let him down by the wall in a basket. All right, turn with me to 2 Corinthians, one more scripture. This won't take long tonight, but it's going to be clear. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse 23. Paul begins talking about how he was in prison, how he'd been beaten, how he'd been received 40 stripes 5 times by the Jews. How he suffered shipwreck, night and day I've been in the deep, verse 25, in journeys often, verse 26, in perils in the water, perils of robbers, perils of the heathen, my own countrymen, perils in the city, perils in the wilderness, perils in the sea, perils among false brethren, weariness, he goes on and on, verse 32. In Damascus, he says, the governor under Aretas, the king, kept the city of Damascenes with a garrison, desirous to apprehend me, verse 33, and threw a window in a basket. Was I let down by the wall and escaped his hands. Now, I've done some research tonight, and I've also contacted our highest authority here, who is Mike Brown, concerning the original language. And, Mike, I want to ask you tonight, that word basket in the original Greek, I want you to help us now because we've got some theologians out here. They're baffled already by all of this. And I want you to tell me, Mike, you've done some research, I'm sure, and I know you know the in-depth meaning behind all of this. What does that word mean in the original Greek?
A careful study of the word in the classical and Koine Greek, considering the semantic domains and the lexical etymological base, indicates that the proper and precise meaning of the word is basket.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you. So in order, I want you to understand that this is not, I'm not off the wall tonight, all right? We're talking a basket. Don't spiritualize this. We're talking about a bucket. We're talking about a woven basket. Matter of fact, bring one out if you got one, gentlemen. I'm sure we got one here somewhere. I want you to understand it. This really happened. Say that with me. This really happened. Okay? Here we got a basket. That's what Saul of Tarsus is talking about. What is this?
Very good. I want to tell you, this is a basket in Norway, it's a basket in Japan, it's a basket in Hong Kong, it's a basket in Colombia, and it's a basket in America. You can call it a Bob Wobway, you can call it a hoopah, you can call it a la-la, it's a basket. That's what that is. It's a basket. And if Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul, was standing with us tonight, he would thank God for baskets. And many of you tonight, you're going to thank God for the basket. This is entitled, Be a Basket Case. Be a Basket Case. I could not believe the spiritual parallels. This won't take but a few minutes, friend, but you're going to understand it and you'll never forget it. And every time you read this, you'll see an escape, a way of escape. Those of you that are bound in sin, those of you that are locked up, those of you that think there's no way out, God's not going to deliver me. I'm telling you, friend, tonight, he's preparing a basket. He's got a basket for you. He's got a little basket. It's made of woven. It's woven, it's ready to go, and he's going to deliver it to you tonight. It's going to be right where you need it at the right time. You got a basket. Thank God for baskets. I'm going to make some spiritual parallels here, and I'm not stretching it. You can take the Word of God, and you can take it and dissect it, look back at it. Say, Jesus, what are you saying through all of this? There's a lot of ways to look at this scripture. I'm going to look at tonight concerning the way of salvation and deliverance from sin. How many will allow me to do that? The first thing you got to do tonight, friend, if you want to be a basket case, you've got to realize the danger that you're in. You've got to realize the danger that you're in. If God is going to deliver you, you first have to understand you need to be delivered from something. Something's going on. Saul of Tarsus had to realize he was in danger. Somebody was after him. Someone wanted to kill him. I'm telling you, who's after you, friend? Satan. Satan is after you. Listen up in the chapel. Listen out in the tent. Listen up in the camp, wherever you're at tonight. Just listen up. You're sitting in the bathroom. Listen up, the speaker's in there. You've got to realize the danger that you're in. Satan is out there to destroy you. These Jews were out to kill Saul. Satan's out to destroy you. I'm telling you, sin is coming to kill you. It's interesting, Saul went from being the persecutor, to the persecuted. I also saw today as I was preparing this, you reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. I can imagine when Saul was standing there going, my God, they're coming to kill me. You know, I know what they felt like just a month ago. Because I was after to kill them. But here we go, friend. If you want to be delivered tonight, if you want God to set you free, you've got to realize what kind of danger you're in. Everyone look this way. Those of you that are playing games with sin, sin will destroy you. Young people, it'll drive you mad. I'm sick and tired of graveyards that are full of teenagers. I'm sick and tired of, the other day I drove down the road and there was a mama out there, a young mama dropping flowers on a fresh grave, and I can guarantee you it was her child. I just know it was. Her little child, probably another drunk driver, probably a kid out there wild as can be. We get calls constantly. My son just died. My daughter just died. How did it happen? Well, she went to a party Friday night, and she got drunk, and she drove home and hit a telephone pole, and now my baby's dead. How old was she? 16. She took the family car. Friend, I'm sick of it. Sin will destroy you. You want God to deliver you tonight, friend? You've got to understand you're in danger. You are in danger. You're playing with fire. Sin will promise you everything and leave you with nothing. It's a miracle of God I'm alive tonight, friend, because a lot of my friends are dead. I can take you to their graves. I went to the funerals. I saw them. I saw some of them overdose. I saw some of them wrapped around trees, dead and gone. I'm alive. I'm telling you, friend, sin will destroy you. It'll kill you. Saul had to realize, I hope you're listening, friend. Saul had to realize that he was in danger. If you want God to deliver you, you've got to realize you're in danger. Those of you that are backslidden tonight, you've got to realize that if the rapture took place tonight, you would stay here. That's danger. That's danger. That's scary, friend. You've got to realize what kind of danger you're in. The reason these baptisms bless me, a lot of these folks will say, I've been in church all my life. And then they'll say something like this, but I came to the Brownsville revival and God spoke to me about the adultery I was in. God spoke to me about the drugs I was using. God spoke to me about the pot I've been smoking and the alcohol I've been drinking and the pornography and the masturbation. You know what they realized when they came to Brownsville? Danger. They're in danger. Sin will kill you, friend. Young ladies, sin is just like that. The devil's just like that guy that'll come up to you and just woo you, sweet talk you, kiss on you, tell you you're the prettiest thing that ever walked on the face of the earth. Lie, lie, lie to you. Anything to get you in that back seat. He'll lie to you. He'll buy you flowers. He'll buy you a pizza with stuffed crust. He'll do anything for you. He'll even go down to Kmart and get a $15 gold-plated promise ring with a genuine zirconium diamond. And he slips that $15 ring on your finger and go, oh, he loves me. No, he wants you. He wants you. And maybe you're costing more than the last girl. Maybe you're costing 25 bucks. He got her for 15. He got her on the first date, but you won't go to bed with him on the first date. It's going to take two or three. You're really hard to get. He's having a hard time with you. Don't fall for it, sir. Don't fall for it. Matter of fact, I encourage every young person in this place, confront facts, truth. If Joe has been in the last 2 years with Nancy, Judy, Beth, Barbara, Katie, and Elizabeth, chances are you're the next in line and someone will follow you. Especially when he says things like, you're not like all the others. Why don't you go to Katie and ask her what he said to her? Sin is out to destroy you and he'll drop you like a hot potato when you come up pregnant. I'm telling you, well, I've spoken in a lot of schools, friend. I've worked with a lot of young people. I'm telling you straight. I know what's going on in the locker rooms. Girls, I want to tell you. In the locker rooms, they'll take your name. And boys will talk about you, and you'll be a street tramp. You'll be a street tramp in the locker rooms. That's why when the guys walk down the hallway, they're looking at you going, huh. You know, they sort of snicker at you, sort of laugh at you, because you've been raked through the coals in the locker room. But boy, he didn't act that way on the date. He was in love. No, friend, don't fall for it. Sin will destroy you. You've got to realize what kind of danger you're in. Is anybody listening tonight? I hope so. Saul had to realize that his life was in jeopardy. I'm talking about being a basket case. Number two, my next point tonight is this. Accept the fact that you cannot make it on your own. This is powerful, friend. Here Saul is. He had to accept the fact. Saul is a mighty man. I mean, he's a mover of men. He's a killer. He's done some stuff in his life. But he had to realize, I can't make it on my own. There's a bunch of people coming after me. I'm one man. There's a group of people coming after me. You see, he knew what that was like because he was on his way to Damascus with a group of people. It wasn't Saul of Tarsus riding on a donkey going after a group of Christians. It was Saul of Tarsus with a group of people going after some Christians. He knew what it was like to travel in gangs. He knew wherever he got, there was no chance for whoever they got a hold of. They were going to die. They were going to be thrown in prison. Saul realized he ain't going to make it on his own. And I'm telling you right now, friend, you want God to set you free? Realize you ain't going to make it on your own. I hope you're listening in the chapel. You've realized the danger? Now what are you going to do about it? You can't make it on your own. Saul's up in this building. He's up at the top. He looks out. It's too far to jump. He can't get out. The enemy's closing in. He's at a place of helplessness. You cannot make it on your own. Every miracle in the Bible, the people realize this. Would y'all listen up? Every miracle in the my testimony is when I realized I couldn't make it on my own. The woman with the issue of blood in Mark chapter 5, after all the doctors, after all the money, after everything she had spent, everything she had done, you'll see in the Bible where she had gotten worse. She realized she couldn't make it on her own. And she said, I gotta find Jesus. If I could just find Jesus and touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. She gotta realize you can't make it on. Let me tell you something, friend. You need us tonight. You need God to touch you. You need this revival. You need this. I don't need nobody to help me. Then how come you keep struggling? I'm telling you right now. I'm not the Lone Ranger. I want people around me. I can't make it on my own. I realized 23 years ago I couldn't make it without Jesus. And I want to tell you something else. I can't make it without John Kilpatrick, Brother Wetzel, Mike Brown, Bob Phillips, David Ravenhill, the rest of us here, Carrie Robertson, everyone on this platform, this prayer team. I can't make it on my own. We need each other. Shoot. How many would accept the fact that you can't make it on your own? So here he is. Here's Saul of Tarsus. He's up at the top. He's looking down. Oh, my God, too far to jump. I'm in danger. They're closing in. They're coming in with torches. They're going to kill me. I can hear their footsteps coming up the back steps. He goes, brethren, what are we going to do, man? I can't make it on my own. I can't get out of this situation myself. The next thing you do, friend, is look for a way of escape. That's my next point. You look for a way of escape. I want to tell you what you're looking for is God's way. God's way. Remember Zacchaeus? Remember that story? Where's that? Luke where? Luke 19. I love Mike Brown. I love you, brother. Oh. Everybody needs a Mike Brown. You know? Matter of fact, now to make little miniature Mike Brown dolls. Little Mike Brown dolls. Where is that found? In Luke 19, Steve. Maybe so. Maybe this is the way we can build that Bible school over there, brother. We pay for the whole thing with little Mike Brown dolls. Look at God's way of escape. Look here, folks. Remember Zacchaeus, Luke 19? Remember what he wanted? He wanted to see Jesus. You know what God's way of escape was? A sycamore tree. He got up the sycamore tree, saw Jesus. See, the bottom line was Zacchaeus needed to be saved. He needed to get out of his sinful condition. What did God provide Zacchaeus? God provided Zacchaeus a sycamore tree. He shimmied up. He got in the Lord's view. The Lord saw him. He saw Jesus. And Jesus said, I'm not coming up. You're coming down. Come on, let's go to your house. Look at God's way of escape. What did he tell Noah to do? Build an ark, God's way of escape. Little David, remember him? A sling and a few slippery river rocks. That was God's way of escape for David. You look for God's way of escape. And here's Saul of Tarsus. It was a window, a basket, and a rope. Let me tell you something, friend. Some of y'all are waiting for a chariot of fire. You're waiting for a chariot of fire, and God's saying, I got a basket. You know, heaven was watching this scene. God knows that's the man that's going to write the New Testament. There he is. Hot water. Hot water. He is in a pickle. And Elijah turns over to God and says, send down the same chariot you sent down for me. Just shoot. Hop on, Saul. We're out of here. No, he wasn't ready for a chariot, friend. He wasn't ready for a chariot. He hadn't matured to that point. He wasn't a chariot man. He's a basket man. He was a basket case. He needed to go through some suffering. He needed to go through some hard times. He needed to learn how to depend on his brethren. He needed to learn how to go through hard, difficult, wondering what's going on times. Boy, you better be listening because this is sure going to make sense in a minute. You look at God's way of escape. I preached last Wednesday night, a week ago, from Matthew chapter 9 about the two blind men that followed Jesus. They followed Jesus. You'll read it later. The Bible says in Matthew 9:28 that they followed Jesus. Two blind men were following Jesus, okay? That's wild, isn't it? We got our eyes wide open and we're not following Jesus. Here's two blind men following Jesus, blind. Where'd he go? They're listening to him. And then the Bible says they followed him into a house. See, those blind men, they'd been on the streets, but they'd never been in that house. Most theologians believe it belonged to Matthew and Andrew and Peter. But they went inside a private dwelling. They followed Jesus right over the threshold and into the house. You know what that is? Unfamiliar territory. You want God to work a miracle in your life? You follow him into unfamiliar territory. You let him take you into unfamiliar waters, places you've never been. And I promise you, Saul of Tarsus had never been in one of these. This is unfamiliar to the boy. That's a basket. That's what you carry fruit around in. That's what you carry bread around in. You don't carry Sauls of Tarsuses in those things. But you look for God's way of escape. Whew, man, I can feel this. I'm going to tell you what's happening tonight, friend. God, right in the midst of many of us, hundreds of us tonight, God's just lowering a basket. And in a minute, he's going to say, get in. Get in. I'm going to set you free. I'm going to set you free. But you're going, I've never been in a basket. Matter of fact, everyone in this place, God, are, you know, they're basket cases. And I can't get in that basket. This is wild, Jesus. The Brownsville revival, I've never seen anything like this in my life. But deep down inside, your heart's doing this. And you're going, something's wrong with my soul. Something's wrong. I feel the Holy Spirit speaking to me. I feel something's going on. Some of you feel pressure all around you. It's like the devil's going, you sinner. You're a sinner. You're a sinner. You're a sinner. He'll condemn you, friend. Then he'll tell you God's not going to forgive you. He'll condemn you. He'll say to you tonight, the devil will come up to you tonight in the chapel, in the cafeteria, wherever you're at, those of you at home, he'll come up to you and say, God's not going to forgive you. Everything the preacher's saying is right about sin, but you've gone too far. You've gone too far. He's a liar. The devil's a liar. God has prepared a basket. He has prepared a basket for you, friend. Now, his way of escape, in just a minute, you're going to hear an altar call. Okay, so lower that basket right in front of your eyes. The next point is this, and I'm going to close in just a couple points. Rid yourself of pride. I love this. As I studied this, I thought, Jesus, I'm so tired this morning, but this is too good. This is too good this morning. I was having a blast because I imagine, they say Saul was like 5 feet tall or a little bit. They say he was a short guy. Some folks do, some folks don't. Mike went. He wasn't as big as Mike, I'm sure. Probably about so tall. But I promise you, this was unusual for him. And Saul, some of y'all can't see his basket. I need to move this thing right up here. I promise you, friend. Isn't that a pretty basket? That's an old basket. Say that with me. It's an old basket. It's a real old basket. Let's see here. Here we go. Saul of Tarsus. Those of you in this place, you're proudful. You're prideful. I'm going to give an altar call. There's sin in your life. There's sin in your life. But you're proud. You might be a pastor. But you're watching movies on television you should never watch. There's sin there. You're a woman of God, but even in this service tonight, you've lusted over some men. You're in this place tonight. You're in sin. You know you're in sin, but here comes that pride. And I can see the followers of Jesus turning to Saul going, look what we found. We found a basket, man. Get in. Get in. Get in. That is dirty. I'm Saul of Tarsus. There's got to be another way. No, friend. But listen, here he is. Saul was somebody. If you don't believe that, listen to this scripture. Me, I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. As touching the law, I'm a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, I'm blameless. Saul was somebody. He was taught under the great teacher Gamaliel. The guy was brilliant. Not the kind of person you'd see in a basket. But you know what he had to do and what you're going to have to do tonight? Rid yourself of pride. I said, rid yourself of pride. You look at that basket and you say, Jesus, I'm at the Brownsville Revival. There's sin in my life. Steve Hill is going to give an altar call. I'm going to get in. I'm going to get in that basket. I'm going to go down board. I'm going to go down there. I'm going to run down there and get my life right with God because you've offered me a way of escape. Get in a basket, friend. Rid yourself of pride. Next thing you need to do, and I'm closing in just a second, is put your trust in God. It's one thing to get into the basket. See, when you're sitting in the basket, it's still on hard ground. Jeff, come on up here, buddy. Imagine this now. Saul's in the basket. It's a long way down to the ground, but he's inside the building still. Pick that side up. Wobble it a little bit. Okay? This is what he felt. Easy, boys. Okay? Put your trust in God, friend. You know how helpless Saul was about this time? Helpless, friend. There was nothing he could do about nothing. He was a sitting duck in the basket. It was over for him. He had to put his trust in God and those men called Christians. They brought him over to the edge. And they got this crazy rope. I don't know where we got this rope. This is a lasso rope. This thing is as stiff. It's like a piece of wire. It's just hard to find good props these days. But they take it. They take it over to the edge. And these people he really doesn't know start lowering. You don't know us. Folks, look at me. You don't know Steve Hill. You don't know Charity. She's going to sing Mercy Seat. You don't know us. We got a hold of the rope, though. We got a hold of the rope. Folks, you got to put your trust. You got to put your trust in God that he's ordained this. This is your way of escape. He's going to let you down to the bottom, and you're going to be set free. He's going to let you all the way down. All the way down. Man, I can imagine, I don't know what it was like, but about the time the basket hit the ground, I can see soldiers with torches running up to the disciples. Where is he? Where is he? Nowhere around here, man. Nowhere around here. You know why? Because Saul put his trust in God, put his trust in God's people, and he escaped. And my last point tonight is this, friend. I told you it was going to be quick. Once you've been delivered, see his deliverance, when he hit that pavement, he set free. He was out of there. Once you've been delivered, join yourself to God's people. I love this. Verse 26 says, and when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he joined himself to the disciples. That's a problem with some of you when you come to Jesus at the Brownsville Revival. You get back out there and you expect your worldly friends to take care of you. No, friend. When you're delivered, when you're dropped down in the basket, when God delivers you, you hit the ground, you join a local church, you get involved with Christians, you plug into the Spirit-filled people, get on fire for God, surround yourself with people that believe like you do. Be a basket case. Be a basket case tonight, friend. God's making a way of escape for you tonight. He's going to show you how to get out of the situation you're in. He's going to show you how to do it. All you got to do is rid yourself of that pride. Get in the basket. I'm going to give an altar call. Everyone all over this campus, as I give this altar call, this is your cue to get into the basket. I'm going to be explaining it. And when I'm explaining it, you're going to be crawling into the basket. And then when Charity begins to sing, we're going to lower the rope. And as we lower the rope, that's you running forward. I want to tell you, when you break away, you'll sense a freedom. You know what Saul felt since when he was going down? He was going, well, whoa. You know, it's over now. I'm on my way down. This worked. I want to tell you, folks, I've watched 300,000 people come to these altars. The testimonies will astound you. You can't put up a sign out front of a church and have 2.4 million people come unless God's moving. They won't come. I don't care who's preaching. I don't care who's singing. Doesn't matter. They're not going to come. God's moving. Got a letter the other day from a man who was a 20-year drug addict. Came to the revival. We just got this letter. My staff's here to back me up on this. Get a letter. 20-year drug addict. Comes to the revival. Gets prayed for. Gets prayed for. The basket. Remember? God put a basket in front of him and said, if you'll go down there and be prayed for, I'll set you free from drug addiction. He sent me a letter. Said, Steve, it's over. It's gone. 20 years of drug addiction is gone. That's so powerful. It may not mean nothing to you, but I promise it means something to his parents and to his friends and to the police department and everybody else that he stole from. It means something to them. Have to get in the basket tonight, friend. God's way of escape sometimes is a little strange. Here's what some of you are saying tonight. You're going to say, man, you know, Steve, you're right. There's sin in my life. But you know, I don't know about that basket thing. You know what I'm going to do, Steve? I can't get in your basket. I can't get in that basket. That's just not me. I can't run down to the Brownsville altars. That's just not the way I do things. But I'm going to go back to the hotel and I'm going to pray. Look at me, folks. Saul didn't do that. Saul got in the basket. You're dealing with a time right now. We're not dealing with a whole lot of options here. You're not dealing with a lot of options. You go back to your hotel room and pray, and this is what you're going to hear. God's going to turn to you as you're over there praying, saying, God, you spoke to me at Brownsville. The Lord's going to say, yeah, and I dropped you a basket. How come you didn't get in it? I was afraid of what people might think. My son was crucified on Calvary. He was beaten. He was whipped. He was stripped. His back was plowed with a whip. He was cursed. He was mocked. He was stripped naked and hung on the cross for you. And you couldn't get in the basket? You couldn't go down to the altar? I wanted another way out, Jesus. That was my way out. That was my way out. Everybody stand. All over the buildings, all over this campus, those of you at home, I want you to stand. I also noticed something. Look this way. Don't move the chairs yet. I also noticed something about this, that when Saul, who became Paul, was telling the church at Corinth about what he's been through, y'all look this way. About the struggles he'd been through. You see, he was beaten, he was whipped, shipwrecked, in prison. He listed all these horrible things, and then you know what he says? And I was also lowered down in a basket. You know how important this thing was to him? If it wasn't for the basket, he wouldn't be writing the letter to Corinth. They'd have killed the boy. If it wasn't for stepping into the basket, that's why Saul was proud. Paul was proud to say, and they lowered me in a basket. I'm sure some of his contemporaries are going, my God, son, forget about it. That's over. Don't talk about the basket, okay? Nobody does stuff like that, Paul. That's what children do, but you're a man. You're a grown man. Don't talk about the basket. They lowered me in a basket. They delivered me from the hands of the cutthroats. He mentioned it right along with the perils he'd been delivered in through, and mentions the basket. That's how important this altar call is right here, friend. You're going to go home, and you're going to say, I was at the Brownsville Revival. It was Friday night. let's see, the 17th? April the 17th, 1998. It's about 10 o'clock at night. Steve gave an altar call, charity, saying mercy seat. I jumped in the basket. I was lowered down to the foot of Jesus. He healed me, delivered me, set me free. And you're going to tell for the rest of your life, thank God for the basket. God's way of escape. Everyone with the chairs, move them to the left and the right. Charity, come join me, sis. Way of escape right here, friend. It may not be what you're thinking. Folks, as they're moving these chairs, listen up in all the other rooms. You want to know what's so pitiful in America and around the world? Is religion. People will hear a message like this. A lot of folks are watching this on television. They're listening by radio. They'll listen to this and you're going to go, they're going, bless God, you know he's right. I'm going to go to church Sunday. God didn't say go to church Sunday. God said get right with God right now. God said get right. God said get the sin out right now. He didn't say go to church Sunday. Do you know what that is? That's your basket. And that's your little thing. I'm going to go my way, God. I'm going to go down the stairway. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. God said get in the basket. But you make your own way of escape and you blow it every time. Devil's going to come in and kill you. He's going to come in and kill you because you didn't go God's way. Oh, I believe in church attendance. Absolutely, I believe in church attendance. But it ain't no substitution for getting right with God at altars. And that's what we're going to do right now. Everybody stand. I can feel his presence. Here's what we're going to do. Everybody stand. Those of you that are backslidden, listen up, friend. You're backslidden. That means at one time you knew the Lord, but now you don't. At one time you were on fire for Jesus, but now you're not. You're backslidden. You're doing things that Jesus would never do. You get a magazine, sir, in the mail. It's a lingerie magazine. It's for your wife. You get it, and you flip through it on the kitchen table. And your hormones are aroused as you look at that thing. Jesus, if that magazine came in his mailbox, would rip the thing to shreds. Never turn a page. He would rip it to shreds. But you've fallen into it. You've been sucked into it. Why? You're backslidden. You're not living for God. A godly man would be appalled at that. A godly man would just, would cringe. He would hurt. Do you live like this, Steve? You better believe I live like this, friend. As a matter of fact, my son and I were coming to church the other day and we drove by our mailbox and there was a lingerie magazine that came in. Most of you get them in the mail. And I'm so serious about it. We turned the car around. My 10-year-old son watched his dad drive all the way back down the driveway over to the trash cans in the back, and he saw his dad rip that thing in 1,000 pieces. My son watched that, and I said, son, if you'll treat sin like that, if you'll treat it like that, boy, never even give it a glance of your eye. You'll live for God all the days of your life. If you let the devil in just one little bit, he'll suck you in. And many of you in this room, within the sound of my voice, you've been sucked in. God bless you, sis. You're at the altar, but everyone else remain where you're at until Charity begins to sing. God's speaking to you right now. He's speaking to you. You're doing things that Jesus would never do. I'm telling you tonight, I'm so confident in this message because God spoke to me this morning about it. He's preparing this basket. He's going to put it right in front of you. If you'll get in it, whatever you're suffering through right now, he's going to set you free. He's going to set you free. He's going to deliver you. You got to rid yourself of the pride, and you got to put your trust in God tonight. Put your trust in God. God knows what he's doing. You know what else? I guarantee when Saul was inside that basket, he couldn't tell when he was going to hit the bottom, where he was going. He didn't know what was down there waiting on him. But God knows. He knows what's waiting on you. Man, there's so much here, it's scary. There's so much here, friend. God knows, those of you that are coming down here like blind faith, you're just, God, what are you doing? He said, just get in the basket. Get down to that altar. God knows what's at the on the ground. He knows what's facing you. He knows where you're going. But it's so dark. It's the dark of night. I don't understand all of this. It's okay. Just get in the basket. I'm going to lower you down, son. I'm going to set you free. You're going to do it tonight, friend. You're going to do it. Those of you that are backslidden, you're going to come quickly. You're doing things that Jesus would never do. It's clear and simple. Sin is anything that Jesus wouldn't do. Right now, a football player is being drugged through the muck and the mire. Reggie White is being drugged through hell on earth by the media. Want to know why? I'll tell you why. I listened to his program. Some of you saw it on speaking to the Wisconsin legislator, and he said some things maybe that he shouldn't have said. But what they're ripping him to shreds about is he started talking about how homosexuality is a sin. And suddenly, all the major money people out there want to pull their funds away from them. They don't want him representing them anymore. You know what he's happy? He's thrilled. His wife is rejoicing that they're being persecuted for righteousness. He says openly in front of America, he says homosexuality, the act of homosexuality, not the homosexuals. He said, I love the homosexuals. But he says homosexuality is an abomination. It's sin in the eyes of God. Here in this place, friend, look at me. Sin is sin. See, there's a lot of stuff I don't look for everybody's opinion on. It's crystal clear in the Bible. Reggie's standing on the word, and it's in black and white here, friend. Clear as a bell. It's sin. And tonight, sin is anything Jesus wouldn't do. And those of you that are homosexuals in this place, and you've been taught the scriptures that David and Jonathan were homosexual partners because they loved each other more than women. Their love was far more greater than they had for another woman. That's an abomination for you to think like that. And those of you, just because John laid his head on Jesus' lap, you think that they had a sexual encounter together. I've heard that preached on. Dear God, friend, you better stay away from that. John was so close to Jesus. He got so close to Jesus, he could feel his breath. And because he got so close, when it came time for the revelation, who did God give it to? Jesus said, Peter, no. Matthew, I love them all. John, my favorite. Jesus has favorites, friend. He loves everybody, but he has those that draw close. Real close, they get the revelation. Those of you that have twisted those scriptures, you need to get on your face and ask God to forgive you. Right now, sin is anything Jesus wouldn't do. You're going to come quickly in just a minute. And also those of you that have never known the Lord, right now in the darkness of night, the Lord's showing you a basket. Whether you're into Satanism, the occult, we had a Buddhist baptized here tonight, friend. God gave her life to Jesus. Whoa! God bless you, sis. God bless you. God gave her a basket. Lowered her down to safety. Now she's set free from Buddhism. Wow. Wow. How about you, friend? He'll set you free, but get into the basket tonight. And there's also a group of people here, you're religious. You're stale, you're dry, you're so far away from God, but you think everything's fine. You think everything's fine. You hear it in the baptismal pool. People say they thought everything was fine until they came to the Brownsville revival. They realize that they're lukewarm, cold. Some of you call yourselves a Christian, but you'll go to a restaurant when it comes time to pray over the food, you're embarrassed. You mumble a little prayer over your meal, and someone can shout out over the intercom system, shout out over the restaurant, all the way across the table. Somebody can say, how about them Green Bay Packers? And you can go, hoo, 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 hoo. But boy, then the food comes and you go, Jesus bless his food. And you call yourself a Christian. You got something to repent about tonight, friend. Bible says if you're ashamed of him, he's ashamed of you. You're ashamed of him, he's ashamed of you. Jesus said, if you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. If you're cold, you're going to hell. See, you get, oh, there's only one temperature. It's hot. Only one temperature. The Lord, I want to tell you, friend, if you read the word, the way is slim. The way is narrow. There's not a broad way to Jesus. There's a holy way, an on fire way, a godly way. It's narrow, friend. I've never had a problem wondering where the boundaries were. It's real clear. Right here. There's not a whole lot of this going on with me. You know, whoa, hey. No, it's like, just like this. It's pretty clear. Don't get irritated with me tonight, friend. I'm trying to help you make it to heaven. I don't want you to be one of those that says, but Lord, in your name I cast out devils. In your name I healed the sick. In your name I built great buildings. In your name I gave to the poor. And he says, depart from me, I never knew you. I don't want you to be one of them, friend. In your name I was part of a youth group. In your name I did this. In your name I did that. Depart from me, son, I never knew you. We never talked. You're supposed to be the bride. He's the groom. He's coming back for you. You're supposed to be infatuated with him tonight. Get in the basket, religious person. Get out of that church rut. Get saved. Get right with God. Pastors, could you imagine if people came to church with Jesus? What it would be like if everyone came to church with Jesus rather than coming and hoping you pump them up. They're supposed to get up with Jesus, come to church. What church would be like? Then a sinner comes in, my God, they're dead meat. They'd get saved just like that. But instead you have Uncle Bob and Aunt Jill and these ladies, men sitting around just grunting, ungodly, been watching trash on television the night before, cussing or arguing before church. They finally get there, and you better have a good message for them because they need a touch. My God, church ain't supposed to be like that, friend. You're supposed to take Jesus to church. So, religious person, I want to warn you, you can go to hell with baptismal waters on your face. You can go to hell with a communion cup in your hand and a wafer in your mouth. You can go to hell with a choir robe on. You can be the founding member of Brownsville Revival, Brownsville Assembly of God, and bust hell wide open if you don't know Jesus. You can be at the Revival School of Ministry and go to hell if you don't know Jesus. I'm speaking to you straight. You can be the evangelist at the Brownsville Revival and go to hell if you don't know Jesus. You can be the president of the school. You can be the pastor and go to hell if you don't know Jesus. Listen to me, friend. Do you know him? Do you wake up in the morning with Jesus on your heart? Do you go to sleep at night with Jesus on your heart? Do you eat, drink, and breathe Jesus? Are you consumed with him? If you're not, this altar's for you. God's got a basket, and you better get in. Charity's going to sing Mercy Seat, and the only thing that's going to keep you back is pride. I've already covered it. Pride says, I don't want to get in the basket. Pride says, I don't want to go down there. You better get in. Charity's going to sing Mercy Seat. If you're away from God, if you need forgiveness, come right now. Hurry, 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 hurry. Make a way. Open up, open up, open up. Hurry. Come on, come on, come on. Hurry in the balcony. Let's go.
Where everything is unknown.
Come on.
I face the power of sin on my own. I did not know of a place I could go
where it,
I could find a way heal.
God's preparing a basket for you. He's preparing a way out. Are you going to get in it? Are you going to sit in it and say, God, lower me down to freedom. Let me down to freedom. But you got to get in, friend. Shake the pride. Get out of your lazy boy. Crawl off of that couch and get on your knees and say, Jesus, wash me. If you're driving in your car, say, Jesus, cleanse me. Wash me. If you're listening on internet, stop right where you're at. Get your hand off the mouse. Get your hand off the keypad and say, Jesus, wash me. Cleanse me. Make me new right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Hurry. 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 Come on. Come on. Come on. Get in the basket.
receive.
Get in the basket, and let the Lord lower you down. Come on.
Mercy seat.
Come on.
Altar call. Matter of fact, come on, team. Lyndall, I'm going to give them about 60 seconds. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads down, but everyone else look this way. You're going to do two things. One is everyone's going to realize that Saul didn't have a whole lot of time to think about it. Okay? And I'm not going to give you a lot of time tonight to think about it. Saul had probably a few seconds to decide whether to get in the basket or not. You ain't got a lot of time, friend. Time's not on your side. Time is not on your side. Never has been. But also, you're going to turn to the person next to you up in the balcony, in the chapel, all over this campus. And you're going to ask them, do you need Jesus to forgive you? You're going to ask them, do you need Jesus to forgive you? And if somebody turns to you and says that, don't lie to them. If you need forgiveness, you say yes. And then what you're going to do is you're going to help that person in the basket. And you're going to both walk down together. You're going to help them into that basket. I want everyone to do it right now. Turn to the person next to you and bring them down right now. Hurry! 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 Come on! Come on! God bless you! have 200 more people. We just had 200 more people come down. God bless you for responding. I want to tell you what's happening. That thing's landing on solid ground. That basket's landing on solid ground. Shoo! Yes! Everyone at this altar, I want you to pray with me right now. Everyone at the altar and all the other buildings, I want you to pray with me out loud. Do not mumble this prayer. Pray with me out loud. Dear Jesus,
thank you
for your way of escape. Thank you, Jesus,
that
tonight you provided a way for me. I receive you.
I receive
that way of escape.
I ask you tonight,
Jesus,
to forgive me.
I have sinned.
I have hurt you,
hurt others,
and hurt myself.
Forgive me,
Jesus.
Wash me, Jesus.
Cleanse me,
Jesus.
Make me new.
I ask you tonight
to be
my Savior,
be
my Lord,
my
very best friend.
From
this moment on,
I am yours,
and you are
mine.
Jesus,
come
live your life
through
me.
In
your precious name.
And
Jesus,
like
Saul of Tarsus,
I'll join
myself
to
the brethren.
I'll become
part
of
the family of
God.
In
your precious name.